What kind of dirt do you have? Under field conditions, plants are grown in soil, which is the top few inches of the Earth's surface, consisting of minerals, air, water, and organic matter that provides for plant growth. Note that loose dirt, of its own, does not constitute soil. Dirt is soil that is out of place, or as many a gardener has remarked, dirt is what you find under your fingernails. Good topsoil has become unlimited, so getting a consistent supply at a reasonable cost can be difficult. Soil is also heavy, which translates into more costs when shipping potted plants. Today, a variety of soilless growing media is available that closely mimics soil. Many mixtures also contain a small amount of soil with artificial amendments, making them better than soil alone or soilless media for specific purposes. For that reason, when the term growing medium is used, it does not always refer to soil or soilless media, but rather to the material in which the roots of plants grow. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I'll talk about soil and soilless media. Why do we need media? A good growing medium is formulated to meet a specific need because different types of plants have different media requirements. Certain media formulations work best for germination and early growth of plants, whereas others are better suited to the long-term growth of the plant. However, all types of growing media must satisfy several basic criteria to maximize plant performance. All growing media must provide the plant with nutrients, which are the substances that roots absorb with water from the medium, not carbohydrates. Anchor the plant to keep it from falling over, provide good drainage and aeration, provide good nutrient and water holding capacity, contain no natural toxins, diseases, insects, or weeds, be reproducible and available, and not decompose and must wet easily. A variety of types of potting media are available, including soil, soilless, mixtures, and hydroponic, each of which has its own advantages and disadvantages. Potting mixtures typically contain organic and inorganic components. The organic matter portion of soil is derived from decaying plant and animal materials. The proportion of sand, silt, and clay contained within the soil is the inorganic portion that determines its texture. Soil must first be pasteurized to kill harmful bacteria, fungi, nematodes, weeds, and other pests or toxins that may be harmful to plants. This can be accomplished by steam or chemical pasteurization. Steam pasteurization, the most common method, sterilizes the soil by aerating the soil with steam at a temperature of 140 degrees Fahrenheit for 30 minutes. The soil temperature in turn rises to 180 degrees Fahrenheit, which kills non-beneficial organisms while leaving the beneficial ones alive. You must be careful not to overheat the soil, otherwise beneficial organisms will also be destroyed, and other problems may arise. The advantages of steam sterilizations are that the soil can be used right after it cools down, and in some cases, soil aeration and drainage are improved. Steam sterilization can also be used on pots, tools, and equipment to kill harmful pests. Plants grow best in soil under field conditions. Soilless mixtures and mixtures of soil and other components are used to mimic nature, which is sometimes difficult to do. As stated previously, the disadvantage of soil is that getting a consistent, reproducible source of soil is expensive. Soil is also heavy, making it more expensive to ship plants that have been potted in only soil. Soilless medium contains no topsoil. The following are common sources of organic matter found in soilless media. Peat is partially decayed plant material composed mainly of organic matter, helping it hold nutrients. Many types of peat are available with varying compositions. The most common type of peat used is peat moss. Peat moss is obtained from moss plants growing in bogs. Specific species are sphagnum and ploetricum, with sphagnum being the most commonly used. Peat is used because of its moisture and nutrient holding capacity. Although it holds water well, it may initially need a wetting agent. Peat moss can also reduce the acidity of the media. Because of the rising cost of peat, bark and other wood products are now being used as alternatives. Bark from both softwoods, conifers, and hardwoods, oak, is used in a variety of potting mixes as a substitute for peat. The bark from trees consists primarily of lignin, which decomposes slowly. Bark also contains major elements such as nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, plus other elements. They are also lightweight. Wood chips and sawdust are also used in soilless mixtures. These also contain a variety of elements. In some cases, these elements are not a problem, but depending on where the tree was grown, high levels of specific elements can pose potential problems. Nitrogen deficiency can occur when adding fresh sawdust into the growth media because bacteria which decompose sawdust first use the existing nitrogen. Some initial nitrogen fertilization should be applied to overcome this problem. Pine and fir bark is more acidic and may need a wetting agent. In addition to organic materials in soilless media, there are a number of inorganic materials that are mineral in origin, containing no carbon. These are the commonly used inorganic materials found in potting mixes. Sand is a commonly used component in many potting mixes because it provides good aeration and drainage. Sand is easy to pasteurize and comes in a variety of particle sizes. Larger particle sand should be avoided because the sand may settle out in the mix and become compacted, which actually reduces the infiltration of water. Perlite is made from light rock that is volcanic in origin. Advantages of perlite include its capacity to provide aeration and drainage, and it can be pasteurized easily. Perlite is white in potting mixes. Perlite also has some disadvantages. Perlite's low weight can cause it to float to the surface of the medium when watered. Perlite also produces dust when mixed with other components of the potting mixture. However, this can be overcome easily by slightly wetting the material prior to mixing. Vermiculite is a lightweight, expanded plate-like material obtained by heat-treating mica. It can be coarse or fine. It has a high moisture and nutrient-holding capacity. Vermiculite is golden-colored in potting mixtures. Handle with care when wet to avoid compressing particles. Various combinations of soil, peat, sand, perlite, or vermiculite can be made. Many companies sell a variety of soil and soilless mixtures in various proportions to maximize the growth of a specific plant type. Some are amended with fertilizer, limestone, or wetting agents to produce a better mix. Soilless mixtures have many advantages and disadvantages. The advantages of soilless mixtures are as follows. 1. Mixtures have good aeration and drainage to enhance plant growth. 2. Mixtures have excellent moisture and nutrient holding capacity to maximize plant growth and development. 3. The mixture is both physically and chemically uniform and can be obtained reproducibly year after year. The homogeneous nature of the mixture makes it possible to standardize a plant's growth and development. 4. Shipping costs are typically reduced because of the lightweight nature of soilless mixtures. 5. Initially, mixtures are fairly sterile, which maximizes seedling growth and reduces chances of problems with damping off diseases, insects, and weed seeds. 6. Mixtures can be custom made to meet specific needs. The disadvantages of soilless mixtures are as follows. 1. Some mixtures are so light that when dry, plants can easily topple over with even a slight wind or touch. 2. Not all soilless mixtures have nutrients added, or they may have nutrients that are not well suited for a specific crop. 3. In some cases, mixtures are very different from what the plant experiences under field conditions. Hydroponics is a method of growing plants in which the nutrients needed by the plants are supplied by a nutrient solution that contains nutrient salts dissolved in water. Hydroponic systems have been used for years to study nutrition in plants. In more recent years, a variety of important crops have been grown successfully under hydroponic conditions. A number of advantages are associated with hydroponic growing systems over soil culture. 1. Plant nutrition is completely controlled. The nutrients contained in the solution can be monitored carefully and modified as necessary together with the pH, which affects the availability of nutrients to the plant. 2. Yield per unit area is greater. Because nutrition and environmental conditions can be regulated carefully, the yield for a given cultivar can be maximized. 3. The need for weed, disease, and insect control is greatly reduced. The main disadvantage of using a hydroponic system is the expense, which is not economically feasible for a variety of plants. For example, hydroponically grown tomato plants generate enough revenue to justify this method, whereas growing hydroponic potato plants do not. Another disadvantage associated with plants grown under hydroponic conditions is algae growth, although this can be controlled with good management practices. Hydroponic systems are classified in two ways, substrate system and bare root system. In substrate system, plant roots are surrounded by either inert or organic materials that provide support for the plant. Materials commonly used for inert substrate systems include sand, gravel, vermiculite, perlite, and horticultural rock wool, mineral wool. Natural organic substrates are typically used in bag culture. Bag culture is when plants are grown in bags containing these materials and are watered using a drip irrigation system. The second type of hydroponic system is the bare root system, in which no physical support is given to the root system, which is suspended in the nutrient solution. Several types of bare root systems are used. One is the aeroponic system, in which bare roots enclosed in a chamber are suspended in the air and a fine mist of oxygen-rich nutrient solutions is sprayed on the roots at various time intervals. Another type is the continually aerated system, which is similar to the aeroponic system except that the roots are bathed in the aerated nutrient solution instead of being intermittently sprayed with oxygen-rich nutrient solutions. There are also floating systems in which the plant is put on a raft that floats on the nutrient solution with the roots completely immersed below. Finally, the nutrient film technique, NFT system, involves recirculating a shallow stream of nutrient solution with no solid rooting medium. The plant is supported above the trough in rock wool or another material that can support the plant, and the roots are placed in troughs with a shallow stream of circulating nutrient solution. The main tank is located at the lowest point of the setup, which contains nutrient solution that is pumped up to the ends of the trough. The solution then flows down a 1% slope back to the main tank, where it is recirculated again. The plants produce a root mat, part of which is above the nutrient solution, while the lower part is submerged and bathed in the circulating nutrient solution. Hydroponic systems are typically used in greenhouses in the winter to grow high-value crops such as tomatoes, lettuce, cucumbers, snapdragons, and a variety of other flowering crops and vegetables. In all cases, aerating nutrient solutions is important to maintain oxygen levels and avoid carbon dioxide buildup, which can be toxic to plants. Soil is composed of rocks, minerals, organic matter, air, and water. In addition to its composition, the soil structure and profile are also key to plant growth and development. The top few inches of the Earth's surface consists of minerals obtained from weathered rock, air, water, and organic matter. Basically, five different factors are involved in the formation of soil: parent material, climate, types of organisms, slope of the land, and time. The three types of parent materials are igneous, such as granite, sedimentary, such as sandstone, and metamorphic, such as slate rocks. The inorganic component of soil comes from several kinds of mineral materials, including sand, silt, and clay. The organic component of soil comes from organic matter, which is the decayed remains of plants and animals. In general, soil is made up of 45% minerals, 25% water, 25% air, and only 5% organic matter. Organic matter is very important for soil productivity because of its source of nutrients when decomposing. Organic matter also promotes the water and nutrient holding capacity of the soil. If the soil is not properly managed, erosion can occur, which depletes the soil of organic matter. Soil should be properly managed to maintain a good amount of organic matter and beneficial organisms such as earthworms, fungi, and others. Proper management of soil includes maintaining physical conditions that promote good aeration and drainage, which allows microbes to do their job. The soil pH should be maintained above 4.5 because acidic soils hurt many soil microorganisms. Soil texture is the proportion of sand, silt, and clay present in the soil. A soil triangle is used as a method of classifying soil on the basis of mineral content texture. The USDA soil textural triangle is easy to use. First, analyze the soil to find out the proportions of sand, silt, and clay. For example, if you have 40% sand, 38% silt, and 22% clay, the first step is to find 40% on the sand axis and then draw a line parallel to the silt axis. The next step is to find either 38% silt or 22% clay. If you choose clay, look for 22% on the clay axis and draw a line parallel to the sand axis to intersect the previous line from the sand axis. The part of the triangle where the two lines intersect indicates the class of the soil texture. In this case, it would be classified as a loam. Soil texture affects drainage of the soil, with sandier soils having more drainage and soils with more clay having less drainage, but more water and nutrient holding capacity. Soil structure is the physical arrangement of soil particles. Soil structure profoundly affects pore size, water holding capacity, and the capacity of water and air to penetrate the soil. Poor soil structure hinders plant growth and development. Factors that have been shown to affect soil structure include tillage, traffic, and rainfall. For example, bringing heavy machinery into the field when the soil is too wet damages the soil and leads to soil compaction, which occurs when soil is compressed into a relatively dense mass. Soil compaction adversely affects pore size, water infiltration, and soil aeration, which is the movement of atmospheric air into the soil. Organic matter or sand can be incorporated to improve soil structure. A soil profile is the vertical section of soil at a particular location showing the various layers, also called horizons, that have developed over a period of time. The development of a soil profile depends on the age of the soil. Typically, young soils show less development than older ones. Soil profiles can be complicated, however. Only four general horizons are discussed here. The uppermost horizon is the organic residue layer above the soil surface called topsoil or A horizon. This layer is where most roots are found and experiences the most intense weathering. The next layer is the B horizon, which has the subsoil layer containing five fine particles, leach materials, and some roots. The third layer, the C horizon, contains parent materials such as weathered bedrock and some leach materials. The fourth horizon is the R horizon, which is made up of bedrock or parent material used to form soil. In conclusion, in this video, you learn the major roles of media and four major kinds of media typically used in horticulture today. In addition, you learned how soils are formed and what they are comprised of. You gained a better understanding of soil structure and soil profile.